Delighted now to be joined by David Connors of the Tuam Herald to look ahead to the final round of the group stages in the Senior Hurling Championship and as well as the intermediate semi-finals this weekend. David, just before we do that, just on the football over the weekend there, Anna Down obviously taking the final place. We were just talking about it off air. It's probably not really something we've seen in the football before. Obviously, the two best third place teams getting through. Anna Down having to win by 12 points, missed a penalty, then Berna get three frees in a row, bring it back to 11 points. And James Healy then in the last kick of the game secures Anna Down's spot in the quarterfinal.
Yeah, you were in it as well. It was a great crack. I had up on Twitter afterwards. It was highly entertaining, and some fella came on and he was just kind of saying, "What? It was a 12-point game. What the hell are you on about?" But like, you just had to be there, and just it was Anna Down against the scoreboard, really. And you know, it looked like they were going to absolutely blow them away with the way they started. Well, I think they were 1-6 to no score up after 12 minutes, and you think, Jesus, this could be any score, really. They could win this by 20 points. But in fairness to Barna, they kind of dug in a bit afterwards, and they did make them work for it. It was like Anna Down started at an absolutely blistering pace. Like they were sprinting to everything, be it a pass, you know, free that they needed to take. You know, they didn't want to waste a single second in trying to get the scoreboard ticking over. But I suppose we were all kind of wondering, would they be able to keep that pace going? And understandably, it did drop in the second half, and Barnett did come back. So, you know, as you mentioned, like 11 points in it, like, it's the stuff of dreams for the goalie to come up, James Healy. And you know what a, like, he should, it looked like he was just stroking over free to make it a 12-point game in a regular game. You know, he was just so relaxed and confident looking, and you know, it was great. Like, it was really, really entertaining. But I suppose, from a Milltown point of view, you wouldn't be overly happy. Like, I suppose, Anna Down, like, and there's nothing that could be done with the tragedy in Barna. But I suppose, like, you know, under normal circumstances, like, Anna Down mightn't have known that they needed 12 points at the start of the day. Like, you know, if the fixtures were on maybe like close enough to the same time or things like that, or Tuam or Curfin were playing at the identical time as well. So there probably is that element. But I suppose around this time, it was unavoided, and Anna Down had a job to do, and did it, you know, they got there in the end, and you know, it was great crack and highly entertaining to watch.
Yeah, it definitely was. The quarterfinals have been fixed for the 8th and 9th of October, so there's double header in Tuam Stadium, Tuam and Salt Hill and Curfin and Montbellew, and then on Sunday the 9th, Anna Down and Michaels and Kilgoyle and Moycullen, and four massive games in the quarterfinals to look forward to. David, I suppose for people in Galway and people outside of Galway, is there a sense that you're kind of glad now that we're pushing in, I suppose, to the knockout stages with the Senior A and Senior B? It just feels like the championship in Galway begins to take a bit more shape than you could say.
Yeah, for sure. I do think the six group game, or the six groups are probably a bit long. It's a bit dragged out. Like, the hurling is, you know, there's a few places and positions and, you know, quarterfinal, preliminary quarterfinal to sort out and things like that. But it just kind of feels like it maybe has dragged a small bit. And, you know, we haven't really seen any heavy hitters fall, really. You know what I mean? The teams that we expected to get through have done so, be it preliminary quarterfinals and quarterfinals. So, it kicks off after probably this round, I suppose. This weekend now, really, teams will kind of, you know, the teams at the top will be looking to reach the quarterfinals directly, and the, you know, the teams coming along, you know, in Senior B will be looking to just qualify and perhaps earn promotion. Like, it's probably the biggest weekend of the year so far, and you know, championship really kicks off from here, I suppose.
It seems like with the teams even coming out of Senior B, you look at Lee Mellows, Portumna, and these teams who are coming through. Like, even when you look at Group 1 in the Senior Championship this weekend, you have Sarsfield, Turnockmore and Clarenbridge, Thomas's. But for them teams, they definitely want to avoid the preliminary quarterfinal, you could say, because even in previous years, that's sometimes where we have seen shocks.
Absolutely, yeah. You definitely have. Like, you've seen, you've seen last year, wasn't it? Kilnadima turned over Turlock, you know, the runners up the years before. And I know Thomas's were, I think it was a preliminary qualifying, like a cup by Kilimer Daly before as well, a few years back. I mean, maybe that was a qualifying, and I was just trying to remember off the top of my head. But yeah, it's just, well, I suppose it's just a game less, you know what I mean? Like, just a lot of these clubs, they don't have huge squad depth. They have, you know, some teams are blessed, all right, but like even Thomas's now, they wouldn't have huge squad depth. So, you know, if you're avoiding an extra game, a chance to pick up injuries, you know, it's just draining, and there's an extra week's break on top of it as well, you know. So it's invaluable, really. And I suppose it's probably, you know, there is the break element to it, but I suppose you can really focus in on a qualifying, and you, from that point on, you can say to yourself, look at it's three games here, three wins, and we win county title. Like, it's, you know, it's fairly easy to break down if you're a management point of view, and you know what I mean, it can really get the players focused. Whereas if you're kind of staring into it, like, you know, if you're from the senior B and you have a cross play round to reach a preliminary quarter final, then you have a preliminary quarter final against the senior A team, like, it can be daunting at times, and you still can seem like a million miles away from winning the Tom Canlan Cup. But reaching the quarter final directly is a massive bonus in Galway. And I suppose, like, all the teams you mentioned there, all of them will be going home this weekend to trying to get there. And I suppose, you know, maybe make a statement against each other as well at the same time. Like,
even looking at that senior A group one, you obviously have the top four teams there, but Clemridge, Thomas's, or Peter, the county final last year, the winner here, you'd imagine, goes through to a quarter final. Thomas's, a heavy defeat. Do you think maybe Thomas's are starting to feel the blow of Shane Cooney gone out of that team now?
Yeah. Well, obviously, like, you're losing a county hurler from a small rural parish. So, you know, and then you've David Cherry missing down on top of it as well. You know what I mean? Like, super solid defender, really one of the best club defenders in the county. So, like, if you're taking them two out of, as I said, a small rural club with, you know, not huge squad depth or anything like that, of course they're gonna feel it. I suppose Thomas is up to that point that they've done enough. Like, they pulled off a brilliant win against Sarsfields in the opening round. You know, they were pushed. Kilimer Daly pushed them for maybe 45, 50 minutes, but then they kind of pulled away for a finish. And then Castlegar put it up to them again. So I suppose it's the weight of the crown of being champions as well. Like, everyone kind of wants to take a scalp against you. And Thurlock Moore completely blew them away last round. I suppose, like, it was a real statement performance from Frenny Ford's side. I suppose it'd be one that would have been looking to lay down a marker early, and by God, did they do it. Like, you know, 15 points against the champions, and I suppose won every area of the field, probably won every position on the field. I can't think of Thomas's, you know, since they've rose to prominence, been bossed as badly as this. Like, you know, they've lost games before, but this was an annihilation, like, you know what I mean? So, Have they come back into the pack? It's, I don't know, like, as I just said in the paper this week when I was previewing it, I suppose maybe one swallow doesn't make a summer. Like, so after this weekend, Clare and Bridger, a brilliant test. This will be, you know what I mean, it's a repeat of last year's final. Neither team, there's a quarterfinal place on the line. I think we'll find out a bit more at the weekend just exactly where Thomas's are at, whether they've come back to the pack, whether there's, you know, there's a bit of those issues or concerns there around players' form or whatever, or maybe the Thurlock Moore game, you know what I mean? They had another shot of reaching a quarterfinal, irrespective of if they won or lost. Maybe they took their eye off the ball. That remains to be seen. So I think we'll find out a lot, you know what I mean? That game is, what, 4:30 on Saturday. So, you know, by 5:45 on Saturday evening, I think we'll know a lot more where Thomas's are, kind of, you know. I suppose you don't go on a 22 game running Galway unbeaten, you know, if you're not a really good team. And I suppose, you know, one loss doesn't want to find them, and they've lost games before. And I think, you know what I mean, this is, you know, it's probably a perfect time for a wake-up call, really, for Kinnebrook side. Like, last thing you want is that a performance like that in the quarterfinals, you know what I mean? It'll, if anything, you know what I mean, the burden of that unbeaten run now, probably, you know, probably ending, really, you know, it takes a bit of the pressure off. And, you know, he's got a good, decent stick to beat them with as well, you know, in training over the next few weeks ahead of any prospective run.
Does it feel like an opportunity for Cambridge? Obviously, they did get close to him in the county final last year, you could say. And I know even you've been doing up the scores throughout the championship there. And Mark Kennedy is really someone catching the eye this year.
Absolutely, yeah. Just on your first point first, I suppose it is, yeah. Like, you know, you lost the county final, you're instantly seeking revenge. Like, we look at the way, you know, in the football, Mount Bellew, you know, the way they want to beat Curragh Finn, you know, irrespective, every time they go out, given the amount of heartache probably Curragh Finn put on them while Curragh Finn were at the top of the table. So yeah, absolutely. And you know, it's a young Clare and Bridge side as well, and I suppose beating the county champions, the reigning county champions, would do the world of confidence of this young team. They're, you know, they're just unbelievable about a young players coming through. Like, it's just, saw them in the, even in the under 20 semi-final, the A semi-final. I know they were beaten by Sarsfields, but like, you know, there's some brilliant young players coming through, and I couldn't get over the standard of that game. And some of those lads aren't actually even playing senior yet. Like, so it's going to be frightening. What they, you know, it seems like eventually it might only be a matter of time before they win, you know, one, and only God knows what it takes from there. But I suppose you have to, yeah, like when Thomases were coming through, Portumna were the team to beat, and I suppose you kind of have to. You have to get over that hurdle first. And when Thomas has got over Portumna, I suppose it was really, I know it was in a knockout game, but it was, you know, it was kind of really, you know, stood to them and it kind of instilled the confidence. And I'd imagine Clare and Bridge will be thinking along those lines. And the huge opportunity as well, like, you know, it'll be, Thomas has probably might have, like, got their confidence a small bit knocked after last weekend, or after 2 weekends ago, should I say. And, you know, it'll be an excellent test. I'm really looking forward to it. It'll be a really interesting game, that one, I think. And just on Mark Kennedy, you mentioned, like, yeah, absolutely. Like, you know, I think definitely I'd be amazed if he isn't, you know, Henry Shefflin isn't in contact with him, you know, maybe at the end of the club season or whatever. And, you know, taking a look at him maybe in a couple of Walsh Cup games and things like that, because I suppose he had a couple of years maybe there where he had a, you know, maybe he was struggling with injury or, you know, and I suppose he's put on, he's got strong looking, the strength and condition they seem to be doing in Clare and Bridge is excellent as well. I've seen someone like, say, Shane Ryan, and he's just kind of, over the last couple of years, he's bulked up, and, you know, that saw him drafted into the Galway panel. So, yeah, absolutely. He's Mark Kennedy's been taking the championship by storm, really. I think, what was it? He scored 1-5, I think, from play again the last day. And he's up near the top, along with Kevin Cooney and Sean Loftus and these fellas that are near the top scorers in player charts. And, you know, they seem to be racking up big tallies every week. So he's definitely one to keep an eye on, and one that, you know, could cause Thomas's problems at the weekend as well.
Just there, actually, I was about to jump on to Turlock Sarsfields game, but Mark Kennedy and Sean Loftus, have they been the two standout hurlers so far throughout the championships that Henry Shefflin might be keeping an eye on for you?
Yeah, I'd probably say so. Yeah, I would probably say so at this point. And maybe someone like Kevin Cooney as well has been excellent. I suppose we're always drawn towards the forwards a bit more than defenders. So you're always kind of looking at the score, the numbers after them, because you wouldn't see every single game. So for me, anyway, those three have probably been, yeah, I'd agree with you. Like, Sean Loftus has been just phenomenal. Like, you know, he looks like a fella that could slot in and perhaps even start championship, you know what I mean, for Galway. He's been in that kind of form. He's been absolutely unstoppable. Like, you know, his stick work is undoubted. He seems to, physically, he seems to come on, and he looks like, you know, he's got a new lease of life in attack as well. Like, even with Galway for years, he was kind of a versatility man. He was never really had a chance to settle down, nail down a position. He was in midfield for a while. He played sweeper. I think he played corner back. I think he might have been even trialed in wing forward and things like, whereas the evidence of what we've seen so far from Thurlock, like, it looks like he could be an option for Galway going forward if he wants to. Like, because I think last year the decision was on Sean. I think he felt maybe this is only me guessing, but maybe he felt he wasn't getting enough of game time during the league or Walsh Cup, and he elected to pull away. And, you know what I mean, he's hurling like a fella that has a pint to prove, really. So yeah, just on those guys, yeah, absolutely, those are the guys that have been so impressed with so far, and, you know, definitely probably the three standout players in the Galway Senior Hurling Championship.
Yeah, the other big game in that group, in the Senior A Group 1, is between Sarsfields and Turnoffmore, ultimately Castlegar and Climber Daly, and there's no relegation this year, with Senior becoming a 16-team championship next year. So that's ultimately a game just for pride, you could say, for both of these sides. But Sarsfields and Turnoffmore, it feels like the under-20 final between the two sides was an absolute classic by all accounts, and it feels like this game is kind of adding to a bit of a rivalry here now between Sarsfields and Turnoffmore.
Yeah, like, they have to play each other, what, three times in a few weeks, and the same lads are probably marking each other in a few of the positions and things like that. But absolutely, like, it's Jesus, like the senior game, the senior and the under 20 game, they're very hard to call, you know what I mean? You just don't know what you could get out of them. Like Sarsfields are, like Turlough are, in the senior, firstly, I suppose, Turlough are, you know what I mean? Like you're coming off the back of beat hammering the champions by 15 points. Everyone is talking about it. And if there's, I suppose if there's one club that are traditionally normally pretty good at bringing you back down to earth, it could be Sarsfields. So you'd want to be, you want to be fully tuned in when you're playing them. Like they're like Sarsfields, like just what a club. Like, you know, I mentioned Roar clubs there, like, but very rarely a year goes by in Galway panels where they don't have at least one or two players on the on a Galway minor panel or series of underage teams. Like they just seem to be able to produce players on a consistent basis, and you know they deserve huge credit for that. And you know their under 20 team this year is absolutely fantastic. Like they've talent all over. They've, you know what I mean, John Cooney, Alex Kinnear, Darren Murphy, you know, the guys like this all, you know, sprinkled around the team. And I it's a game that's probably, for me anyway, you know, I know the Thomas and Darren Bridge game is probably a repeat of the final last year, but I think this is a really intriguing game, and it's probably the game of the weekend for me, I've been honest with you. Just on the balance of Turlough, you know what I mean, they're on the back of beating Thomas's, they're now coming up against Sarsfield, so a match for anyone. They're probably in maybe, you know, top four anyway, top three maybe in Galway in terms of being favourites of the championship. And I suppose it's going to be really interesting. I suppose Turlough have received plenty of criticism and I down through over the last few years in terms of, you know, I suppose there's a lot of questions about their attack and whether the scoring power up front, you know what I mean, to really, you know, win a county title. And I suppose they put that firmly to bed against Thomas's. Whereas I was at their game against Clare Bridge, and you know it looked like that old issue was rearing its head again. But this year now they've Fergal Moore back, like even against Thomas's, he was in full forward. He's a real handful. Like he kind of tied up Fintan Burke. He didn't allow him to do much else. He kind of for a full forward, he was kind of stopping Fintan Burke's influence, like, which is an unusual. You know, they've Tom Quirk, lovely young hurler, capable of a goal. Barry Cannon, pretty much a goal machine, you know what I mean? And then you have Sean Innan on the comeback trail from a cruciate, and he seems to be playing himself into a real bit of form. And
a lot of people have forgot, like, Conor Walsh being out for Turlough this year, like, it's a significant blow, and just doing it all without him. Like, as you mentioned there, a couple of the fours, like, he'd be a massive blow to that Turlough side.
Absolutely, and I suppose no one has stepped up more than, as we mentioned already, than Sean Loftus this year in terms of taking on the freeze. He's, you know, he scores some play, etc. So yeah, this one's a fascinating game, really. I suppose like there's some huge matchup there. Like who will Turlough probably put on Kevin Cooney, who's like, you know, he's in Erling Haaland goal scoring form. I think he's a goal a game, or I think he's 5-4 or something like that. Like it's, you know, it's one of those. One of those records that you're, you know, you, I think a few weeks ago, Erling Haaland to be proud of. Turlough have countless defenders that, you know what I mean, that they have plenty of options back there, whereas the questions were in attack before about them. And I suppose against Thomas's this year, the answer to that was, I suppose at the end of the day, it's only a group game as well. And, you know, and I suppose Turlough will probably be fully aware of that. And I suppose it's championship where they'll probably need to deliver. And I suppose we need to remember with Turlough too, like they were only, you know, a puck of the ball away from beating Thomas's a couple of years back. And, you know, that was with Dahi Burke gone out injured as well. And we saw what Dahi Burke did against Conor Cooney for Thomas's, like he completely tied him up. And seemingly before that, with Dahi tying up Conor, like, Conor had looked simply unstoppable, you know, for the last 3-4 years. He'd been the standout club player in Galway. He'd be seemingly unmarkable, like, you know. So it just goes to show that if you can kind of tie up Conor Cooney's influence, maybe, you know, Thomas's mightn't be, you know, they might become under a bit of pressure, although they have plenty of other options as well. So yeah, this for me, Sarsfields and Turlough's real interested, most interesting game probably the weekend. I'd probably, you know, flip a coin, really. I couldn't even try and pick a winner in this one, to be honest with you.
Stick of them too, like, they seem so close where it could nearly be a possibility that you could get two draws out of it this weekend.
Absolutely, yeah. There's no reason why you couldn't be, like, you know what I mean? There's absolutely, but, like, I suppose from a Thomas's point of view and a Sarsfield's point of view, they won't want draws, so they'd be, you know what I mean? Like, they'll want maximum points on the board, and, you know, they'll want I suppose they all really, they probably all want to win. You know, when you're playing, you're going to be playing these teams later on, it's no harm maybe either to, you know, kind of lay down a marker and, you know, say, we, you know, it can be very easy team talk. We bet these team earlier on, we're showing we're more than capable of doing it. So, you're bang on the money there, Paul, though. Absolutely. Draws in these would not surprise me in the slightest.
Looking at the other group then in Senior A, Loughrea, Kilconnor and Loughrea, the one team already through to that quarterfinal spot. Then you have Gorse coming up against Crowell, and it's ultimately a game to see who gets fourth place in that group. And then the game between, you have Captagal and playing Tommy Larkins, and ultimately that's the game then for second place into the quarterfinal.
That's it exactly. I suppose, like, you started with Loughrea there. I suppose, like, you know, great year for them so far, going about their business very quietly and, you know what I mean, very effectively and quietly, you know what I mean. 4 wins from 4, you know, haven't really put a foot wrong so far. They've huge squad depth. They've been winning games even without maybe their star attacker, Jamie Ryan, absolutely, you know, on fire like he can be over the last couple of years. It's been players like Joe Mooney, Mark McManus, guys like that stepping up, like, and Neil Carey, hugely reliable on the place balls as well at the same time. So, like, they've, like, Loughrea, if, you know, you just look down through their panel there, like, they've so many options. Like, you know, you can bring on, you know, so many players that have hurled senior beforehand, and, you know, there's a considerable amount of options there. Like, they're definitely a team that no one will probably want to play in a quarterfinal, you know what I mean? They know now they have plenty of time to adjust, and they can, you know, they can offer lads an even longer break at the weekend. They can give some French players a rest, and if there's one team that has the players available to them, you know, that they can, you know, make 6, 7, 8 changes, that's Loughrea at present. You started in with the Gorch and Crowell game. You know, Crowell, a draw will be enough for Crowell, obviously, but, you know, it's a win that they'll be after. I suppose, interestingly, Crowell's manager, Andy Cohen, he's Gart man, he captained Gart to county title, what was it, in 2011, I think it was. And you know what I mean? So it's just another interesting subplot there on that. So it's, you know, like, Gart, incredibly, they've only beaten Kilkenny in the last round, and they can still leapfrog Crowell with how things are playing out. So,
in that game, Gort obviously going for a lot of youth this year, and you just feel with Crowell, they've desperately missed Nailey this year.
Yeah, like, if free taking has been an issue, it seems to be, like, you know what I mean, like, Niall Healy is probably, you know, maybe the elite free taker in Galway, like so dependable. Doesn't matter the situation, he's just calm and composed. You've seen him nail so many late frees and, you know, get important scores for Crowell, and he's a huge loss. Like, and Tom Onan is an exceptional hurler, but maybe free taking isn't his strongest thing. And I suppose they even brought in, was it Keelan Cullen, I think, the last day, you know, to strike the dead balls for them for Crowell, which is, you know, which was an interesting thing to see. You know what I mean? They had a couple of misses and things like that. So Niall Healy's loss is big. Like, they've had a couple of injuries as well at the same time during the year, and I know they had a couple of fellas away, so that, you know, with the split season as well, you know, lads are going to travel to America and things like that. Like, it's understandable. I suppose Crowell have borne the brunt of that more than anyone. But, you know what I mean? Like, this is a clash of two teams that made the semi-finals last year. We need to remember that. And one of them is going to bow out at this stage now. So, like, as you mentioned there, Garter, you know, it's kind of a Garter in transition, really. Like, but, you know, they still have some exceptional leaders, like your Aidan Harts, your Craig Lally's, your Jack Grealish, your Jason Grealish, these type of guys that have huge experience, and it's up to them to kind of guide the younger fellas. But they've huge talent as well. Like, so it's a fascinating game, this one. Like, you know, I suppose, like, where they stand, like, Gort haven't really impressed so far, but then they blew away Kilkenny, whereas Crowell started well. Then they, you know what I mean? Like, they got a good draw against Capitagal as well, but they've, you know, for periods against Loughrea, they were only okay. And then I think, what was it, 4-7 they conceded in the second half against Tommy Larkins, and they eventually lost by 12 points. So, you know, it's a difficult one to call. It's hard to know where they're at. Like, you can't really read much into Gart's probably win over Kilkenny, because Kilkenny have been beaten by an average of 15 points this year. And just on Kilkenny, like, it's a really difficult year for them, because they have a lot of players absent as well through injury and through lads away. Like, and I suppose, you know, having the having the knowledge that you're not going to be relegated this year was probably, you know, taking the pressure off a small bit, like, you know. And, you know, I suppose maybe this year might stand to them and they come back refreshed next year. But the Gorton Cromwell one, it's you know, it's very difficult to call. It's good going either way. Probably slightly edged towards Cromwell, but, you know, I can't imagine there's going to be a lot in it.
Who do you see then getting the second place in that group going into quarter final? Would you see Captagel or Tommy Larkins?
I probably slightly go for Tommy Larkins just on the balance of, just on the way things have panned out so far this year. Like Jason Flynn, like, is obviously Tommy Larkins' marquee attacker, but like he's had serious help this year from Conor Gardner, Ronan Murphy, you know what I mean? Like Colin Flynn in midfield, like probably one of the best midfielders in the county. Like they're, you know, they're some excellent hurlers, Tommy Larkins, Kevin McHugh, go Cahill Toohey, the fullback, the Vienna Murphy in goals, like the, and, you know, the best goalkeeper in Galway, like, you know, on that basis. So they've a really good squad, and Sir Farrell is obviously back involved with them as well this year. So that's a really interesting one. And sure, Jesus, no one in Ballykill or Woodford would be more respected more than Sir Farrell. So I'm sure the squad would be eager to, you know what I mean, to do all they can for Sir and Noel Murphy, who's with them as well. He's the Ronan and Anna's father. So yeah, I'd probably slightly go towards Tommy Larkin, should I say. Cappy have been good in patches, you know, they haven't really been very consistent so far. They've looked good for spells, they've looked okay for spells, I suppose. But Capitec are sort of team that kind of only really come alive in the knockouts. Like, it's, you know, they normally kind of just about do enough in the groups, and then, you know, it's a one-off game in Kinney Park or Duggan Park or something like that, where they seem to come alive. I know they were caught last year against Gort in Pearce Stadium, but, you know, they've an exceptional attack, Capitec. Like, they've a huge threat. Like, they've, you know, the two Collins is Niall and Liam, like Gerald and Mannion. They've Dan Nevin, you know, like they're really stacked in attack. Like, I'd expect a kind of high scoring game, to be honest with you, in that one. And maybe just, you know, just on form, I'd probably lean slightly towards Tommy Larkins. But, you know, again, a cap attack win wouldn't overly surprise me.
Then just going on to the Senior B Group one, Moycullen have obviously been one of the stories of the championship. But I was just even looking at something they had up on Twitter during the week. Keane Folan, who plays football with Clannan and hurling with Moycullen, like, his scoring stats, like, when you consider really probably for 12 weeks now, it's been football hurling every second week for him.
Yeah, absolutely. They're remarkable. It's absolutely remarkable. Like, we have some excellent dual players in Galway, like, and you know what I mean? He must be right to the top, like, the board. And say Dahi Burke or someone, a few of the other guys that are playing, like, but like phenomenal, really is, like, just that you can do it, as you said, week in, week out, 12 weeks in a row, no break. And like, he's just like, he looks like a fella that's in phenomenal shape. He's a great burst of pace, and you know, he's kind of playing in similar positions of both them, like in the inside line, and you know, he's well capable of winning his own ball, and like, he's been a huge asset to both them, like, so far this year. And like, just for Moycullen alone, like, that's, you know, like, what a story. Like, you know, as again, as what is it? Three of the last four champions have got promoted from after they win in the intermediate. They've gone straight up to Senior A afterwards. Like, it just goes to show the momentum that you can get from winning. Like, if by winning an intermediate title, that you can, you know, you can be on a crest of a wave and just kind of keep it going. Like, as they say, like, you know, losing is a habit, but like, so is winning. Like, winning is a serious habit. Like, and it looks just like they've hit the ground running. Like, they were always an excellent team. Like, you know what I mean? Like, they probably would have felt they might have probably came up sooner, but they've had that, you know, a couple of years maybe with the two Davrins, Colin Cunningham and players like that. And they've kind of really developed into, like, Fionn McDonagh as well. Like, you know, unbelievable, like, player. Like,
he's been without him in a few games as well.
Absolutely. Like, you know what I mean? Like, and he was playing the Fitzgibbon team for NUI this year. Like, you know, like a serious target man, but he can hurl as well. Like, he's... You know, like, for fellas, like, you know, looking at them, like, he'd be a fella that you'd be thinking that could be making an impact for Galway, given the attributes he has, his ball winning, he's hurling, and, just a different option there. But yeah, like, it's a phenomenal story. Like, but like, the gas thing is, like, you know, it's you know, like, they still, you know, they're still not in a preliminary quarter final, because if Oranmore Mary beat them, like, you know, they go into the crossplay round, and you know, it just becomes that bit more challenging, you know. So the head promotion sealed and secured and delivered, but they've still another job to do, and I suppose they'd be really wanting to finish the season out strong. Like, a disaster would be to lose to Oranmore Mary, like, and then lose your crossplay round or something like that, like, and then you're out of the championship. And you know, like you're facing into senior A next year, then with on the back kind of two disheartening enough defeats. So like they still have a job to do. I suppose Oranmore Mary are a really tricky opponent to have, like in the last round. And you know, there's plenty riding on it, and they'll be so eager firstly to kind of to cement their, you know, to get the spot in senior A firstly, and then, you know what I mean, for next year, and then kind of have a crack at the knockouts. And you know, preliminary quarter final, they'd be a team that no one wants to play. Like there's some unbelievable young players coming through, like your Patrick Burks, your Ruben Davis, your Anthony Keady, like you've Rory Burke coming through in the next 2 years as well. Like it's like they really, you know, they will feel that with the players that they have coming through, that like they do not want to spend a year in kind of, you know, no point in saying, oh, it's kind of a graveyard in senior B next year, where it's, you know what I mean? I know there'll be a trophy on the line, but you're not really playing for much. Like, you know, you're only just playing for promotion. So, and there's only going to be likely only one team going up. So it's, you know, it's invaluable that, you know, that they do probably feel like they get promotion. That's probably why I probably would fight, kind of give them the edge this year, maybe against, or give them this weekend, maybe against Moycullen. I think they might just do it, and they have the experience of being there and maybe doing it in the past, and, you know, that could stand to them.
What's your thoughts on that? Obviously, there's going to be senior, then there's going to be senior B, and there's going to be intermediate. Obviously, the intermediate winners will still represent Galway intermediate level. So senior B, you're ultimately only playing to either go down to intermediate or up to senior. Like we've seen it in Dublin, for instance, they were on a senior B, but obviously the eight teams going down all at once at intermediate level wasn't perceived well at all. A lot of objections by clubs weren't happy with it. But then to have, I suppose, this senior B, and it'll have no, I suppose, interchangeability with senior A, like, do you think it's going to work, or do you just think we're going to have to see it for a year and see how it plays out?
I'll take a look at it for a year. I'll be honest with you, my own personal opinion is I don't see it working. Yeah. I just don't see how the interest is going to be generated. Like, take, for example, the four teams in intermediate this year, like your Clymer, your Rahone Newcastle, your Meelik Aircourt, and your Ceylon, like whichever one of them like wins, like it'd be great, like the celebrations would be incredible. But then when you're reflecting it, like you realize, geez, I cannot win. Like I have another hurl now that I need to go over here to have a shot at even winning the Tom Canlan Cup. Like, you know, it's, you know, like that's what the teams dream of at the end of the day. And you want to be playing for the biggest prizes. Like, so for me, I don't know, like teams in Galway are like, and I don't want to offend anyone or upset anyone, but they're kind of obsessed a small bit with senior status, which is, you know, like there's nothing wrong with hurling intermediate. Like I've been involved with Athenry intermediates in the past. I've seen so many intermediate games. Like, and is that, like, I suppose there is the fear that lads might, you know, like if they feel like we're an intermediate club, you know, they might drop away. But I don't know. Like it's like, I think you kind of have to play at your level. Like, you know what I mean? Like, and if you're good enough to stay in 16 teams in senior, you're probably, you know what I mean? If you're like 16 teams is probably plenty for a senior championship. Being perfectly honest with you, 24 was too many as it was. Like there's such a gap between the top and the bottom. It wasn't even funny. Like, I don't want to write the whole thing off beforehand, but like, can you really see interest like being massive in this senior B championship where there's only going to be one winner? There's like one up, one down. Like the kind of like once the groups are over, a lot of teams will have nothing really else to play for. You're kind of, if you come up from intermediate, it's kind of a no man's land. It's kind of a challenge. It's a purgatory place really, where you're stuck in, like, and you're there all. Personally, I know what would probably they'd be upset about it, but I think they should be intermediate. Like, it's, you know, like imagine what it could do for you going on an Ireland intermediate run, like we saw with Oranmore Mary and what it meant to them, like, and getting the team to play in Croke Park and winning, like competing, representing Galway on the national stage, would be, in my eyes, would be worth a whole lot more than, you know, just about clinging on to senior status and even clinging on in this senior beat kind of thing. It's, I think most teams will try and want to avoid it. Like, I don't think anyone would be very happy, but it's such a pity this year for the intermediate champions, whoever they are, that they will have to go into this competition. And I suppose, like, it makes it very difficult for them to go up, but I suppose you'd never know whether it works or not. I don't know. I wouldn't be a huge fan of it, to be honest with you. I think, you know, hopefully, please God, down the line that we can see a bit of an adjustment in it, and, you know, maybe tweak it here and there. But I don't want to write it off entirely before it even begun, but I don't know if the interest will be there from the neutral, really. And, you know, I suppose that's the big thing at the end of the day. But clubs clubs love holding on to their senior status, particularly in Galway hurling. So, you know, this is kind of, this has been created for that purpose. And I suppose the end of the day, it's the clubs that have the vote, and it's not me or you. So they're probably kind of voting for what's best for them, and I suppose not maybe what's best for Galway hurling, or what's best for, you know, the neutral looking on, or you know what I mean. So yeah, I suppose we'll just wait and see. I don't know. I wouldn't be hugely captivated by the whole competition, to be honest with you. But look, we'll give it a year or two, and we'll probably make a judgment then.
You mentioned that Moycullen or Moy game first versus second, and we're talking there about Senior B. It makes for the clubs involved in this the third spot even bigger. Really between Kilnadeen and Leitrim now and Aston Rye. Beha obviously just above relegation playing Kilnadeen. Teen Average and Nairi wanting to avoid a relegation battle, and they're coming up against Aston Rye. But who do you see getting that third spot for the cross playoff? You could see between where they could play Moycullen or Oranmore.
I probably see Aston Rye, to be honest with you, just because they have the superior head to head record, and they are playing winless kind of Teen Average and Irie in the last round, who have nothing to play for, and their sole focus now will be on that relegation final, be it against which one of Pierce's, Mullia and Haskafona. So Aston Rye would definitely be in the driving seat. Like Beha is not an easy task for Kilnadeen and Leitrim either. Like, they're probably one of the teams like Beha have nothing to lose at this point, and you know they're really a team that you don't want to be facing into when you're trying to fight for your survival either. Like, so I suppose the interesting one, like, is if Moycullen beat Oranmore Mary and after the other two teams win, but Aston Rye and Kilnadeen, it comes down to scoring difference then, which can make it really interesting. So both teams, like Aston Rye in particular, will be keeping a close eye on what Moycullen are doing. Like, and if Moycullen are beating, you know what I mean, Oranmore Mary, like it actually could almost be a disadvantage to them. You know what I mean? Like, it could technically be a disadvantage to them, because their scoring rate is actually the worst of the three teams. So, you know what? Now they are playing, as I said, Teen Average and Ireland. They will be probably likely expected to win and win comfortably. But whether they can close the gap, like, what are they have? They have -7, whereas Oranmore Mary, like, are +19, and Kilnadeen and Leitrim are +14. Like, so it's, you know, you're up against the cosh there straight away. So, like, it's finally balanced, that game. Like, and it's definitely one of the games where, like, Aston Rye management to Kilnadeen management will be, you know, will be eager to put across the point that every point is invaluable. Like, and you know, well, I think we'll, you know, it'll be very interesting to see how it plays out.
Even if you're looking at the other group, Portumna already look cemented through in the Senior League Group 2 to the preliminary quarterfinals. And if you're just thinking second and third, barring any shocks, really, you'd have to go along the lines that it's probably going to be Ardrahan here and Liam Mellows.
Yeah, you probably would. No, just from an Ardrahan point of view, I can't think of, like, Pierce's are, you know, they're not a nice team to play against. Like, and I mean that in the most complimentary way possible. Like, they're so dogged. They rarely cough up big scores. They're rarely blown out of it by any team. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you look at there, they've scored 66 points, but they've only conceded 74. Like, it's, you know, it's a fair record for a team with only one win in the standings so far. Like, it's not an easy task for Ardrahan. I suppose the only thing that's going for them is like, from Pierce's point of view, the score difference should be enough to keep them safe, even if they are dragged in. Even if Haskafona beat Mullia and Pierce's do fall to Ardrahan, you'd imagine the scoring difference should be fine for Pierce's. They're probably safe. Like, so maybe that's encouraging from Ardrahan's point of view. So that likely puts them in a strong spot. And I suppose Mellows, you know, I mean, the two teams, Ardrahan and Lee Mellows, they're both guaranteed crossplay regardless, but it's just for Mellows, if they can beat Portumna, it kind of puts them back into the reckoning in terms of, you know, in terms of maybe getting the one of the senior A spots. So that's massive for them. Like, if they beat Portumna and Ardrahan win, it comes down to scoring difference then. And like, they have a sizable advantage on Ardrahan at the moment in terms of scoring difference. So that'll be another one to come into. Like, it's as you know, it's head-to-head if it's only two teams, whereas if it's three teams, it comes down to scoring difference if they're level on points. So it's fascinating, really. It's finely balanced. You just mentioned Portumna there. Like, can we just, like, I saw them a couple of years ago, and, like, you'd be thinking, Jesus, this is only going one way. They only seem to be going down. But, like, what a job, like, Jimmy Havern and, you know, like, Ollie Canning and Chunky Hayes and these guys have done, like, you know what I mean, Damien Coleman as well, like, that are involved with them this year. Like, they look like some turnaround, and they won the under 20, was it A1 or B championship this year? They annihilated Lee Mellows in the final. Like, and so many of their players were actually, their senior players this year were playing on it. You have the likes of Martin Toohey playing, you have Declan McLaughlin, you have Adam Fogarty, you have a load of these guys that are, you know, still playing senior.
With that under 20, was there only something like 17, I think, on their overall panel, I think.
And so many of these guys are, like, so many of these guys are hurling senior as well at the same time and putting in serious performances. Like the biggest compliment you could give to Portumna this year is, like, most of the time, like, they're not even relying on Joe Canning to win it for them, which seemed to be the case for a good few years there. Like, you've so many guys that are stepping up. Declan McLaughlin, like, who was on the under-20 panel for Galway last year, I think I was saying he started the game against Kilkenny. Like, he's just kicked on. He looks like a serious club forward, and it's the potential, you know, maybe if he keeps going the way he is, like, he could be an option for Galway further down the line in terms of the Galway seniors. Like, you've Jack Kenning, who's had some excellent games. You've, like, Martin Tuohey, I think he scored 1-4 from play or something like that, 1-2 or 1-4 from play the last day against Mullia. Like, and they had only 13 men, like, and I think they were 12 points down at one point, and they managed to turn it around. And, like, Joe's influence is obviously incredible, like, you know what I mean? And just, like, what a player to have, like, in your squad, like, to look up to. And, like, imagine just for the younger guys to even get the opportunity to line out with him, and, you know, the words of advice he can bring, and, like, the way he can just bring players into. But it's like, but this modern Portumna team, particularly 2020 and 2021 from last year, like, they look like they're going places. Like, they look like they potentially could be, you know, one of the challengers, maybe, you know, in the coming years. Like, so it's fantastic to see, because you'd worry for them when all those guys stepped away, but they've really transitioned into, you know, and they've done some job out there. And, like, the management team at the moment and whoever's been bringing through these players, like, they deserve tremendous credit. And, you know, like, 4 wins from 4 tells its own story. Like, that's not an easy group. Like, and, you know, it'll be very interesting. I suppose the last job they need to get done now is to beat Liam Mellows on the final day. But they look odds on for Senior A hurling next year. Like, and, you know, it's great to see.
6-6 then in Senior B Group 1 and Group 2 for the relegation. It's looking like at the minute where you could have a potential relegation final of Tina and Ascrafona at the minute.
Yeah, well, Tina in the relegation final, regardless of what happens. They're down now at this point. So it's just a matter of kind of holding on. Like, they just about held on last year to beat Ballandarian by a point in the middle of winter. Like, I think it was late December or something like that before. It was eventually sorted. Like, and I think it was something really low score. Was it 12-11 or 13-12 or something like that? So they'll just tell you the kind of weather it was at the time. They managed to get over the line. But it's been worrisome looking this year for them. I saw them in one of the games there. We them the first day out, and they look very disappointed. It was actually against Kilnadeemalitra blew them away. Just, like, looked leaky in defence. They were kind of, Paul Killeen has been a massive loss. He's obviously gone to London over the last couple of years. Like, so defensively, they've missed him. Like, they have some fine hurlers, like your Johnny Conroy's, your Shane Maloney's, your Pádraig Breheny's, guys like this. But, like, you know, you probably need a couple of lads coming through every year, and maybe they haven't had that over the last while, and maybe the guys coming through haven't been able to make the step up quite as easy as they might have liked. So, yeah, so they're going to be fighting for their lives, I suppose. At the moment, it looks like a Haska, but like a Haska, like, have the two Mannions, like, and, like, if there's two players that could kind of get you out of a hole, it's probably them with Sean Blaine, you know what I mean? Like, and, like, you should have a nice spine there. They probably feel like they haven't performed. It's been, like, a couple of years since they have won a game at senior level. Now, I think their last win was a preliminary quarterfinal. Was it against Cromwell a few years back? Like, so it's, you know, it's been kind of downhill since kind of Kevin Ward has kind of stepped away, and things have been difficult for them. But they'll be eyeing up that Mullia game. They know if they get a win, it kind of puts them back into the reckoning. But Mullia aren't an easy team to play against. As I mentioned, what they did, I've seen them against their defeat against Ardrahan, and they were excellent. Ronan Glennon, maybe if he didn't get injured in that game, he they had to move him in full forward because he picked up an injury and he was kind of bossed around midfield. And if he didn't pick up an injury, maybe they could have come away with 2 points in that. They might have been looking up rather than down. So it's going to be a fascinating game. It's a really interesting one. It's probably one of the standout games of the weekend. That one, really, like, you know what I mean? Because while you're fighting for their safety, Pierces are probably fine, you'd imagine, unless they really take their eye at the ball against Ardrahan. And Ahascafona need to win. So it's, you know, it probably is, like you said, though, it probably is looking like Ahascafona and Tina Abidinari in the relegation final. And, you know, it's, you know, you don't know what could happen in a final like that, depending on the weather. It can depend on so much, like, you know, sending off or anything like that can change the balance. So you'd be looking to kind of stay up if you can at all and avoid it.
Yeah, some of them games just as big as a county final for those sides. Moving on to the intermediate, David, you're obviously working with the Tuam Herald, and, like, I suppose around Tuam and the around areas, safe to say there's a lot of talk about Cylon in this intermediate semi final against Clonmore this weekend.
Absolutely, like it's like, just the last 2 years have just seen Cylon transformed, really, hasn't it? Like, you know, they've gone from kind of odds or ends and maybe teams that might be, you'd be thinking, will be happy enough to preserve their status, to now, like, you know, in the first semi-final, they've made back-to-back quarter-finals. It's, you know, it's fantastic what they're doing, like, in that pocket of North Galway. And, like, I've been kind of looking out for Cylon for the last 2 years because, obviously, we'd cover them a bit more with the Tuam Herald. So, than most teams, and, you know, you'd always be keeping an eye out for the results, but they seem to be getting so much right. Like, they have a couple of great young players coming through. I saw a couple playing with Kalash de Ballaclare last year in the was it senior B or it's like, it was Sean Newell was playing for them. Like, I can't, the other guy's name kind of escapes me, like, and they seem to be, you know, developing lot excellent players coming through. And, you know, like, once these guys keep coming through, it's a great sign for them, really, like. And you know, like, that was a really challenging group they got out of. Like, you know, it was probably the toughest group in it, really. Like, you have Spiddle, all right, who have dual commitments, like, but then you have, like, you have Ballandarine and Turlock Moore, like, and, you know, Ballandarine were one of the favourites to win the championship. They were probably favourites from the outset, like, you know, given the players they have, and they would have been disappointed to get relegated last year. Then you have Turlock Moore, like, perennial, you know, knockout stage qualifiers since they've gone up intermediate. And then you'd Canvara then in the quarter final, like, Canvara with Conor Whelan back, all right, fair enough, he had been abroad and maybe he mightn't have been as sharp as he might have been, but, like, they still managed to get over the line. Like, it's fantastic, like, and they seem to have a really nice system of play. Like, we mentioned their physicality, but by God, can they hurl too, like, and, like, they've really, like, their half back line, I think it's like everyone is 6 foot plus, and, like, you're not able to rain ball down on top of them. Keelan Craven is one of the most free scoring forwards in the competition. And yeah, they've just, like, you've Alan Cunlan, John Igno, you've guys like that, like, that are, you know, chipping in with scores every single day. So it's, you know, it's a shot to nothing for them in this game against Clymer. They were only beaten by a point last year by Clymer as well. I think it was a deluge kind of game. In was it a new win or Brolin or something like that? You know, they'll be going in quietly confident. I don't see why they wouldn't. Obviously, Clymer are the favourites, and, you know, they're being driven on by what happened last year. But, like, if you kind of start looking too far ahead, that's when you can be caught. And, like, Cylon are a dangerous team to have to play. Like, they're not, like, you know, they're probably a bit different than most Stirling hurling teams. Like, they maybe like to run the ball a small bit more. Like, they might, you know what I mean, they're capable of winning ball a bit more capable than maybe a few other teams as well. Like, so. And they're going to throw everything at this. I just seen, like, posts on Facebook, and they're getting the flags ready and things like that. So they're going to bring a big crowd. I know they brought a big crowd to Gort when they played Canvara in the quarterfinal as well. So it's promised to be a fantastic occasion, like, really, the semi-final weekend. And, you know, it could be a real cracking game, this one, like, you know. And, you know, it'd be some story if they were to reach a semi-final or a county final, should I say. You know, given their geographical, you know, where they're based, and, you know, it's, you know, you're competing with football there as well at the same time. Like, a football will always probably be number one in North Galway. In fact, it will be. There's no probably about it. Like, but, like, to be able to achieve what they're able to do, and, you know, you know, just kind of keep football alive, really. It's fantastic. And, you know, I suppose plenty of neutrals like to see them go, see them go all the way, although probably some will as well for Kilmer, rooting for Kilmer after the heartbreak of last year.
Yeah, as you mentioned, they played out a cracking game last year. Kilmer only getting over the line by a point. And they've looked impressive, Kilmer, as well throughout this championship. But, like, I suppose some people might think this might be a step too far for Kilmer, but it's definitely one you can see going right down to the wire.
Absolutely. Well, most people would probably have Kilmer favourites for at this point. You know, like they're hurling like a team that has, you know, has something to prove. They have a target in their sights and that's what they want to achieve. Like there's some excellent hurlers. Like you just go down to their team. Like you have your Andrew Carey, your Kevin Henney, your Jack O'Mara, Jason Broderick. Like you've guys there, like excellent players for this level. Like, you know, and they're big and strong as well. And they actually, you know, in comparison to most teams, they probably do match up quite well physically with Cylon. So it'll be very interesting to see how that goes. I suppose, like, no one would begrudge them, you know, after, you know, a county title this year, after how things finished last year, and, you know, and the heartbreak of that, and, you know, the last minute goal, and probably the mistake by Sean O'Grady. Without Sean O'Grady, like, I'd probably put that record, like, without Sean O'Grady, Kilmer would be, you know, they mightn't be where they are today, or they mightn't be where they got to last year, because my God, he's a fantastic keeper. He's arguably the best keeper in that competition. Like, so, like, they're probably a lot of them are trying to do it for him as well this year, and I'm sure he's very eager that if they could get their hands on silverware. But it's a really interesting game. Like, it's, you know, it's one where Kilmer will be expected to win, but, like, you know, Cylon are going to be troublesome opponents at the same time.
The other quarterfinal as well, Brahim Newcastle at Meath Airport in Kenny Park on Sunday as well, after that Cylon Kilmer game. Both games are streamed live by GoGA as well over the weekend. But similar, Kilmer, Rahul Newcastle, Meath Airport, like, when you look at the record in the Intermediate Championship over the last few years, they're three teams that have been thereabouts every year.
Absolutely. And I suppose there's a feeling maybe in Meath Airport in particular that they probably should have come up by now. They've been one of the tip teams every single year, but for one reason or another, they haven't been able to get over the line. Like, I a lot will be made of, you know, the likes of John Fleming, and, you know, I suppose John Fleming, I think he only came on the last day. He's obviously on the county panel, like, and, you know, like, they've been able to get to the stage with him either nursing injury and being absent, or, you know, just coming in. So, like, but I remember seeing Meath Airport a couple of years ago, and they were in a minor B final. Like, Lee McDermott was playing that day, and he's been, like, one of their standout players this year. Like, so they've got a lot of change out of that team as well. Like, it's, you know, it's very interesting, like, this East Galway thing, like, you know, because a lot of them, these clubs have had to be forced to amalgamate due to depopulation. And I suppose that's probably why a lot of these teams, and I touched on it in the past there with the Senior B, and, you know, they want to, as many senior teams as possible, kind of to keep hurling pretty much alive in the area. And I understand that argument too. But yeah, it's like, it's a very interesting game, I suppose, for Rahul. As you mentioned on both the records there, they you know, this is nothing new for these teams. Either these teams, they've been in the knockout stages before. Rahul are, you know, they're a really good team. They look in excellent form this year. Like, it's like, you go down to it, even minus John Hanbury, who hasn't played over the last years. Like, his brother Colin is fantastic. Like, he's arguably the best man marker in the entire competition as well. Like, he's a captain this year. You've Tony O'Regan kind of showing up things at centre back. You've Andy Dunn, you've, like, Willie Mackey, you've Eamon Brannigan, sure. Like, what did Eamon Brannigan score last year? Was it 7 points in play or something like that? Like, and, you know, I know he was involved with the Galway development squad in terms of hurling this year. Like, so he's obviously eager to sharpen up his hurling, and maybe he's pushing for, like, you know, maybe you're looking at the Walsh Cup or something like that. But, like, it's really interesting. Like, this game is fascinating, really. Like, it's a team, like, whoever wins it, like, will really fancy their chances going into a final. And both teams, like, there should be nothing in it. Like, I suppose the defining factor could be, like, John Fleming. And if he's fit enough to maybe play, like, he could be the swing factor in this. And he could potentially be the difference between Meath Airport winning and losing.
You see a Meath Kilmer final?
Yeah, that would be probably what I'd fancy, to be honest with you. No, I wouldn't be surprised if the two other teams either, like, in a Meath But the yeah, they probably the East Galway, maybe slight derby or whatever you call it, would be the one that you'd be expecting to happen. But like again, like these things are so finely balanced, and intermediate is such a, you know, no more than the football, like, you know, one off day and you can be caught, like, so it just goes to show like what teams will be, you know, guarding against complacency. And like I suppose like you probably shouldn't be complacent in a county semi final, but you just never know how these things pan out.
Yeah, the intermediate relegation final takes place on 2:45 on Saturday between Castlegar and Kilbeggarty. Then you have the two junior A hurling semi-finals on Sunday. Ballygar taking on Sarsfield, and Skahanam on Ballymoyle taking on the Mellows. Just on that in the junior A, David, like there's a real possibility of a local derby, you could say there, potentially, where you could have a final between Ballygar and Skahanam on Bally.
Absolutely, yeah. It's fascinating, really. Like it's both teams kind of again deep in football country, but like they're, you know, like it would be a phenomenal achievement for the, both these teams. Like Skahan and Montpellier, my lot, they've a lot of young players. Like they've had players on county underage panels, and we only need to look at like Sean McDonough, who was like young hurler of the year. Like, and commendable in fairness to Sean McDonough that he stuck with Skahan and Montpellier, my lot, and you know, like he's willing to try and come up through the grades with them. Like, you know what I mean? So like, if they could get to intermediate, it'd be massive. Massive, like, and that would be a real novel final, really, with Ballygar as well. Like, oh, like Skahan and Montpellier have had players underage. I know they've lost the two Thomases to Castlegar in recent years, but they've had like Michael Flynn and other players like that that have been involved. Like, and I know when I was with Athenry Intermediates a few years back, and we played Ballygar in a challenge game, and they ended up beating us. Like, they were so impressive. Like, and it's kind of it would be like, it's great to have second teams coming through, but I suppose like, you know, you'd like to have the, you know, as many first teams as high up as possible. And like, I think it'd probably be a final that both teams would, like a lot of people, neutrals in the county would be shouting for.
Absolutely. So there's some intriguing action to look forward to this weekend. That's all on our show today. David Connors, thanks for your time.
No bother, Pop.